Greetings, Warriors of Khaurhalia. We are back with the final development update of Early Access. But just before we move on to take a look at some of the recent changes to the game, we want to start by thanking you all for your incredible support during the development of Bannerlord. Your feedback, suggestions, and bug reports have been essential in bringing the game to this point, and we really appreciate your patience, cooperation, and input throughout the Early Access period. Thank you. We also want to take this opportunity to say that this is definitely not the end of the road for Bannerlord. We'll continue to support the game well into the future, including content updates. You can read more about what we have planned in our release plans blog post. There's a link in the description below. Okay, and now on to the game. To start, we have a few combat related updates to discuss, the first of which is the addition of banners. Banners are equipable items that provide various combat bonuses to your formations. Banner bearers can be promoted from regular troops to carry a formation's banner into battle, buffing the troops around them. And if the banner bearer happens to fall, other troops from the formation will attempt to recover the banner and continue the fight. There's a total of 45 different banners across 3 tiers for you to earn by accomplishing various tasks, like defeating enemy nobles, clearing high notes, and reaching certain campaign milestones. A number of impactful changes to the spawning of reinforcements were made to address many of the issues that arose when one side was pulled into their opponent's spawn area, especially during larger battles. With the addition of 2 extra spawn paths for each side to spawn on, reinforcing waves are now able to select the safest route when joining the fray. Additionally, reinforcements will now always spawn near the initial deployment boundaries and attempt to join a formation that matches their unit type when entering the battle, with the weakest formations being bolstered first. Combat mechanic effects like knockdown, knockback, and dismount are now decided using a standard and deterministic model, making them much more reliable and predictable. You can check the tooltip icons to see each weapon's effect. Armor damage calculations were reworked to make higher tier armors more effective against blunt attacks, making these armors feel like a much more worthwhile investment, particularly when confronted by looters. And for the final combat related highlight, the AI movement system was overhauled through a range of physics adjustments, better situational understanding, and by implementing a partial 360 degree import for the AI, massively improving issues with troop congestion and the AI's ability to deal with more difficult terrain, especially in sieges. Response times for defensive formations moving to position have been improved, and the AI is now much more efficient when redeploying troops between formations. Attacker behaviour was also reworked to focus its energy on fewer siege engines and breaches if it has a smaller force. Campaign AI also received a number of notable updates recently, with many of those changes aimed at improving party and army decision making to make the world more active and dynamic. To achieve this, the weight of party priorities was increased, with defensive parties sticking to protecting their own territory, while those in an aggressive stance will try to raid and siege enemy settlements more often. Also, the threshold for changing party objectives has increased, meaning that parties are now more likely to stick to their current task if it makes sense for them to do so. Parties are more likely to attack settlements that are near their own territory, and will try to coordinate with nearby allied parties when engaging the enemy. And parties within armies now take fellow army members and nearby villages into account when sourcing food. The decision score calculation of patrol, defend, and besiege stances was adjusted to increase siege success rates and the overall aggressiveness of AI armies. And the cohesion boosting behavior of armies has been improved, particularly when undertaking important tasks like defending or besieging. And finally, armies with low cohesion or that are not at war are now automatically disbanded, and each active army decreases the creation chance of a new army. These changes ensure that there are fewer, larger armies on the campaign map, resulting in more significant and decisive battles. Developing your character is one of the most rewarding aspects of any Mount & Blade game. However, the progression system could be a little inflexible when trying to adjust your strategy mid-campaign or experiment with different playstyles. Well, now you can visit an arena master to reset the skill perks of you, your family members, and your companions. Additionally, the way the NPC child skill and trait levels are calculated was improved, with children now receiving skills and traits periodically instead of all at once when they reach adulthood. Also, the equipment selection system for newborns now considers different parameters, such as culture, traits, and hero type. They say that friends are the family that you get to choose yourself, and that would be an apt description of companions in Bannerlord. But unfortunately, and perhaps a little too realistically, as the playthrough progressed, it became harder to find companions in Khaurhalia, especially in the late game. A new companion spawn behaviour was implemented to address this issue by equalising the companions in the game. In addition to this, companion skill traits were rebalanced and many of their backstories were updated to provide more variety and options for you to choose from. And alongside these changes, you can now ask tavern keepers about available companion candidates, making finding those new friends even easier. In Bannerlord, your duty is to your clan, and as the head of the family, you need to make sure that your clan remembers it. The recent changes to clan management allow you to do just that by giving you even greater control over your clan members and parties, including exchanging and assigning party leaders, recalling clan members to your party, and dispatching clan members to your settlements. NPCs will now approach you with various propositions, including mercenary contract offers, marriage offers for clan members, and vassalage offers, building on the game's existing diplomacy options to make the world feel more active and alive. For some time now, we've been working on a number of adjustments and balancing changes to trade goods, caravans, and workshops with the aim of improving the overall health of the economy, particularly into the late game. You can read about the changes in detail over on our forums. There's a link in the description below. But to summarise, we've increased the demand for trade goods, rebalanced luxury demands to make them more relevant, tweaked a few prices here and there, and made some changes to workshop production. Of course, it's worth remembering that Bannerlord's economy is huge and has many moving parts, so we will continue to monitor the situation and take feedback on board to ensure that the economy remains in good health well into the future. For all you crafty crafters out there, changes that aim to provide a little more structure to the crafting path were recently introduced, including separating the unlocking of crafting pieces into their respective weapon types, with crafted weapons now only giving experience for that weapon type alone. Additionally, crafting parts are now unlocked gradually, with tier 1 parts coming first, then tier 2, and so on. 14 new heads and 5 new handles were added for you to make two-handed maces with, which are a thing now by the way, and most pommels are now available to use across other weapon types. Finally, you can find 19 new cloth and fur pieces to attach to your pole arms for some added flair. A broad selection of cutscenes was added to highlight and commemorate those special moments during your adventures. From the birth of a child to the death of a comrade, and from joining a kingdom to destroying one, cutscenes give more weight to key events while helping to bring your own unique story to life. A broad selection of teen scenes was also added, with 10 new battle terrains, 2 hideouts, 2 castles, and 16 towns for you to explore and conquer. You can find more information on the new scenes, like their names and locations, in the 190 patch notes. There's a link in the description below. And for our final single player highlight, we have the, almost obligatory at this stage, additions to the Calradian Armory. But alas, there are simply too many to share in this video, so you'll have to check them out yourself in game. Over in multiplayer, we have Battle, an intense single life game mode intended for organized events. At the start of each round, you select a class to spawn with stronger classes requiring more gold. Gold can be gained from kills and assists, and by surviving the round. To win, you must completely destroy the opposing team or break their morale by holding more flags. Custom server files were released to Steam users, allowing community members to host their own dedicated servers for others to play on, including modded content with new scenes, game modes, and more. And speaking of modding, Steam Workshop support is now available, with many user-created modifications already available for you to explore. Elsewhere on the modding front, we recently shared API documentation for Bannerlord to allow modders to effectively use and integrate the API with their creations. And that's all for Development Update 11. We really appreciate you taking the time to check out the video and hope that you enjoyed the updates to the game. You can find links to the full patch notes in the video description, and as always, we invite you to share your feedback with us in the comment section below.